The Legend of Heroes is a long-running and venerated series of video games that have produced no shortage of legendary titles. In particular, The Legend of Heroes Trails of Cold Steel 2 was one of my favorite video games I've ever gotten to play. Just a couple of weeks ago, the third installment of the Cold Steel chapter of the series was released in English to high appraisal. People everywhere are giving it the same sort of critical response one would expect from the same series that brought you Trails in the Sky and Cold Steel 2, which has left me feeling utterly baffled. Trails of Cold Steel 3 is, in its totality, a good video game. It has some excellent characterization from its side cast and some resonant moments of character depth with old favorites from the narrative, but is also lacking so much of what it was that made the stronger installments in the series as strong as they were to begin with. I'm going to break down some of Cold Steel 3's shortcomings for a moment, contrasting them with the strengths of Cold Steel 1 and 2 to see just why it was that finishing Cold Steel 3 left me feeling so empty. And to start that off, many of the game's larger problems can be seen by examining the microcosm that is its main character, Rein Schwarzer. Cold Steel 3 is the first time that Rein lacks a definitive character arc that guides his actions. In Cold Steel 1, Rein's arc was defined by his feelings of inadequacy. His training under Eight Leaves was cut short because he was too out of control, and so he goes to Thor's essentially running away from home. But over the course of the game, he learns from people like Laura and Eustace not to give up on the sword, while also learning from the class as a whole that it's okay to have weaknesses, that one can overcome them with the help of others. Most of his character arc happens in the background of the main events, but every chapter there's one point or another where Rein is challenged to take another step. This continues to Cold Steel 2. Here the focus of Rein's character is in his feelings of responsibility. It was literally his weakness and his weakness alone that resulted in him having to leave behind all of his friends and classmates at the end of Cold Steel 1. His arc in 2, therefore, is about him learning that he can't do everything alone, and moreover that he shouldn't have to do everything alone. He learns that people care about him just as much as he does them, and that no one wants to see anyone suffer as they try and carry the weight of the world alone. After all this setup, Cold Steel 3 starts off in a fairly logical way with regard to Rein. Rein is disillusioned, given his false title as the legendary hero the Ashen Chevalier following the Civil War, with his actions in Crossbell and Northumbria in particular deviating from his own stalwart sense of morals and purpose. Furthermore, he's still shaken up about the truth about Chancellor Osborn being his father, as well as the death of Crow. All of these are logical starting points for his character. The problem is how they get utilized. Throughout the narrative, Rein isn't really growing. All these things are presented early on as things Rein is dealing with, but never are they persistent struggles with which he has to overcome. Instead, what primarily takes their place are scenes in which people tell Rein that he has to rely on his students and co-workers in the same exact way they do in Cold Steel 2. On scant occasion, such as a few poignant scenes with Randy and Toa, Rein will lapse back into dealing with these new problems he has, and those are some of the very best scenes in the game. But overall, it doesn't feel like Rein is growing with the narrative, which in turn doesn't make it feel like this is really his narrative at all. Which ties into another flaw in the way the story is structured, and that's the topic of motivation and action. In Cold Steel 2, it was clear what everyone's motives and desires were. Rein wanted to reunite Class 7 and end the Civil War. Cayan wanted the noble faction to win and to strengthen the weakening aristocracy. The only question mark was Ouroboros, but I'll get to them in a bit. The characters were all actively pursuing tangible goals, directly impacting the story. It was the pursual of these goals that forced them all to grow. What does Rein, or for that matter anyone, want in Cold Steel 3? They want to know the truth. Cold Steel 2 ended in such a way that grossly expanded the scope of the narrative and the details therein. It left the cast searching for answers to a seemingly endless stream of questions. However, the problem is that this is a passive goal, not an active one. Rein, on account of having a job and being a teacher, is not actively doing anything to get the answers that he wants. He just goes through the plot until someone shows up that can give him a portion of the truth. This means that there's nothing definitive that Rein is working towards. He's just letting the story move him, as opposed to Cold Steel 2, where he himself moved the story. To contrast it in another way, consider the actions of Joshua in The Legend of Heroes Trails in the Sky second chapter. Joshua wants revenge on Ouroboros and seeks that out actively, even going so far as to leave his party behind. This lack of direction ties directly back into the lack of character arc that Rein has overall, and leaves him feeling far less important in the story than he actually is. And this trend can really be seen across a large portion of the cast. Now, this game has a gigantic cast of characters, taking not only most of those present in Cold Steel 2, but also incorporating many from Trails in the Sky as well as Trails in the Zero, while also incorporating around 30 new ones altogether. However, very, very few of these characters actually either A, grow in some way due to the events of the narrative, or B, directly impact the story in a clear and important way. And sadly, the largest culprits of this are the original Class 7. All throughout the game, the original Class 7 appears periodically to assist you. However, almost all of them suffer from the same problems that Rein does. They all just ambiguously want the truth, without having the means or knowledge to pursue that truth. Furthermore, for the majority of the members, their arcs are done. They appear in the story because this is a Cold Steel game, not because they need to do anything in any capacity. The one notable exception to this trend is Millie Marion, who is actively traveling the country in search of Ouroboros, and through her interactions with Altina, demonstrates that she is still growing more and more every day. But so much of the cast is just there for the sake of being there. In addition to just cluttering the narrative, it takes time away from the characters, mostly the branch campus students and staff, who actually do grow and impact the story. Put another way, it seemed that a primary concern of the game was just being fan service over being a concise narrative. For example, take two of the characters from the Crossbow arc that appear in Cold Steel 3, Randy Orlando and Teo Plato. Randy, in spite of not having appeared in any Cold Steel game to this point, gets fleshed out considerably. He has a character arc that is directly tied into the game's greater ideas about unity and understanding that helps Serene cope with his own grief and inadequacy. He's from a different game originally, but he plays a major and active role in the game now. Teo, on the other hand, is there simply to be an ambassador of the Crossbow games. Nothing that she ever does impacts the story in a major way, nor does she have anything even resembling a character arc. In the end, she participates in the fight for the Grawl, but I can't feel anything about her, because unlike Randy, the only reason I care about Teo is because of what she did in past games, not this one. She's fanservice, where Randy is an element of the plot. And this division between the goals of the development has large rippling effects on the game's structure and themes. Put simply, the game lacks any sort of strong and clear thematic backbone. Going back to Cold Steel 1 and 2, the themes are clear as day. The games are about seeing past the differences we have with one another, to realize that we're all the same. We're all just people and we all just want to be understood and have a place where we can belong. This is shown through the Once of Classism, which is a motif in Cold Steel 1 that grows into the primary conflict of Cold Steel 2. And so I ask, what is Cold Steel 3 about? At times it touches upon racism, at times it touches upon grief, but there isn't a straight answer that is reinforced by the story directly. In Cold Steel 1, the first chapter of the game takes place in Celtic, where the students learn that there's friction between the commoners of Celtic and the provincial army, which represents the nobles running the area. The very first chapter of the game starts off by showing you that there's a problem in the country between the commoners and the nobles. In Cold Steel 3, Chapter 1 has you go to St. Arc, where you get attacked by Ouroboros and you need to stop them. The only thing that occurs here that has any bearing on the actual story is that Rean learns about the tragedy of Hamel. There is no theming that happens here. We don't see any racism or xenophobic fear in the people of Erebonia, nor do we get the groundwork for anything else to come. Instead, we just see a lot of things. We see a bunch of members of Old Class 7. We see Duvali and Shirley. But to what end? Every event in Cold Steel 1 was building the issue of classism up. It was priming the narrative to go into the civil war of Cold Steel 2. But the starting chapters of Cold Steel 3 feel much more like episodic adventures where the only point of their identical structure is to find and stop Ouroboros from blowing things up with a robot. Which, I'm sorry, is conflict for conflict's sake. It leaves Cold Steel 3 being a black and white story of beat up the bad guys, both with Ouroboros and the Chancellor, whereas one of the greatest strengths of Cold Steel 2 was its fantastic gray morality. Crow had good reason for everything that he was doing. As corrupt as many of the nobles were, the commoners were pushing for a warmongering war state in their place. Furthermore, the people that you were fighting weren't just psychopaths who only wanted violence. You got to see all of them in a casual context and understand that Duvali, Leo and Zeno, SNV, Vita, and Crow himself were all just normal people like you, who were all doing what they thought was right. Duvali has a childish sense of justice and innocence. Leo and Zeno were shown to legitimately care about Fi. SNV have perfectly reasonable reasons to have wished for the death of the Chancellor, and Crow, time and time again, proves that he loves everyone and just wants the story to end with as little senseless violence and death as possible. Of these characters that return in Cold Steel 3, only Duvali maintains that nuance, and even then, it is grossly watered down as she loses much of her screen time to the other Stahlritter and Leanne Sandlot. In their place, we get Shirley, who is a warmongering psychopath, Campanella, who is a warmongering psychopath, and Rooker and Leanne, who don't get any of the humanizing moments that made the antagonist and cast so wonderful in Cold Steel 2. And in having so much of Ouroboros be represented by psychopaths, it makes them feel so much more like a crazy group of evil people than it did in the other games. All of the relatable or understandable members are either missing in action, rest in peace poor Blue Blanc, or otherwise don't get to do anything. The best moment that any of the members of Ouroboros had in Cold Steel 3 was after Black Alberic blew up the Courageous and multiple members of Ouroboros remarked about how awful and unnecessary it was. It made them feel like they weren't just a bunch of cartoon monsters. But aside from Duvali, this is pretty much the first time the player is ever led to think that there may be something more to these people. We get told that we should care about Leanne and Rooker because they're strong. Whereas in 2, we decide to care about Duvali, Leo, and Zeno because we talk to them. We learn about them and the reason they fight, and we understand them. It presents this idea that in a perfect world, we could get along with these people as well. That they really aren't that different from us. All of that is gone in 3. Rooker is the closest the game comes to trying to characterize any of its antagonists, but even then he doesn't come close to the level of empathy built up by subordinates, which themselves don't get to do anything in the narrative. Cold Steel 2 was all about understanding and peace, which was enforced by the story reaching across the aisle to show that everyone could be understood. Lacking a driving theme, Cold Steel 3 just features a menagerie of villains doing bad things because they're bad. Any greater motives are made invisible to the player, and there isn't any intrigue in any of those members of the cast going forward, since I never cared about them to begin with. And we can break down this lack of focus into the very structure of Thor's itself. In 1 and 2, classes were split among Noble and Commoner, with Class 7 representing unity and accommodating both. The very structure of the school reinforced the themes and direction of the narrative as you got to see not only this division, but see how at Thor's these bounds were being broken as Nobles and Commoners alike all became friends regardless of class. In Cold Steel 3, the class divisions are arbitrary. There's nothing special about any of them, and especially not Class 7. In Cold Steel 1, the purpose of having the game take place in a school was to show the problems that Erebonium was facing on a small scale, and show that, as ingrained as the problems were, they could be overcome. There is no driving reason for why this school structure is the same in 3, other than that they wanted the surface gameplay to feel like 1. Deliberate design choices are now being used without their original intent. The cast of the Branch Campus is great, but what is any of it supposed to mean? There's Yuna, Tita, and Valerie, who are all from recently acquired pieces of the country or otherwise a foreigner altogether, but they never face any prejudice from their Erebonian classmates. Perhaps one might say that this is to show that Erebonia can overcome its xenophobic racism, but the problem there is that that xenophobic racism is by and large something that is only ever told to you. You need to go far and out of your way to actually see any evidence that the Erebonian people are being prejudiced towards Calvard or Crossbell or anything else. If anything, it's Yuna that's unjustly prejudiced towards Erebonia. And even then, if that was the goal, it's sloppily executed. In Cold Steel 1, you get to see that within Thor's, by and large, the Nobles don't like the Commoners and vice versa at the beginning of the game. It was only as the story went on that these deep-rooted prejudices came undone. We saw it happen, as opposed to just being told that it was the case. And on the subject of racism, the game seems highly confused with what it says and what it actually does. The only thing you ever know that the Republic of Calvard does in any of these games is be antagonistic to Erebonia and the Nord Highlands. At no point am I actually given any reason to think that Calvard isn't actually a bad place. But on the contrary, a lot of time is spent dealing with Crossbell. We're shown there being tension in Crossbell and even spend a whole chapter on Crossbell in spite of the fact that the game is not about Crossbell. And in the end, you do feel sympathetic to the plight of Crossbell through action. But I'm also supposed to feel sympathetic to the Republic of Calvard in spite of the fact that all I know them to do is to be antagonistic. This comes back to the idea that the game is structurally divided. Most of the first few chapters have no bearing on the story that comes after. It should only be natural that the Calvard tension is almost non-existent then, as it was never the point of the first portion of the game. But if that's the case, why make it such a vital part of the narrative? The game's first half doesn't set up the second half, and the second half doesn't build upon its first half. This leaves characters like Kurt and Yuna feeling significantly less important than Musei, Ash, and Altina, as the former only matter in the first chapters that have no bearing on the actual plot of the game, while the latter three are crucial to the events of the main scenario. Kurt especially feels completely left behind compared to his classmates, only really having any strong character moments in the very first chapter. Now, none of this is to say that the game is all or even mostly bad. Most members of the Branch Campus are excellently written, with Randy, Major Irving, and Toa being some really strong pillars holding up the narrative. Outside of them, Claire and Sarah get some wonderful and much-appreciated character development that ties into the sub-theme of moving on past tragedy, and that sub-theme is executed wonderfully. The one-off stories of these characters tie directly into those of King Eugent, Queen Priscilla, Sharon, and of course Reen himself. They show how a bunch of legitimately hurt and broken people can keep walking in spite of their burden, alongside the help of other people. They show how everyone just wants to be understood and live a life they can be proud of. And the payoff of these scenes is fantastic. When Sarah broke down in tears, telling the Northumbrian Jaegers that they weren't living up to her father's memory, or when Major Irving and Claire opened the music box together to see the pictures of them all as children, I was nearly brought to tears. But sadly, this is a very small portion of the narrative at large, which is so bloated with characters and more concerned with being cool than being meaningful that it loses a lot of what made the second installment one of the best games ever. Is Cold Steel 3 bad? No, not even close. But does Cold Steel 3 live up to the weight of its predecessors? No. Not even close.